Hi, I'm Tricia Anderson.
Hi, I'm Dory Rhodes.
Hi, I'm Mike Rosenberg.
Hi, I'm Jacinda Barbahan.
Hi, I'm Ann Karen.
Hi, I'm Mary Lou Bossom.
And we are the board of Bedford Embraces Diversity.
We are here to welcome you to our video episodes of Faces of Bedford, where we celebrate the wonderful diversity of our neighbors. Bedford Embraces Diversity, dedicated to fostering a feeling of inclusiveness in our small town, is proud to introduce you to members of our community that represent a variety of different religions, race, sexual orientation, economic backgrounds, and culture. We sincerely hope you enjoy meeting them all. Thank you. Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining us for yet another episode of Bedford Embraces Diversity's video interviews, Faces of Bedford. Today, it is my pleasure to welcome both Bobby Annis and Mike Rosenberg.
Thank you.
Both of who are very long-term residents here in Bedford, and as you will be hearing from them, have been extremely active in both town and community activities. So let's get started. I'm sure the audience would love to hear about your backgrounds, your families, anything else you want to talk about. I'm always curious about when you did come to Bedford, where you moved from, and why did you choose Bedford as a place to live? So who wants to go first?
Go ahead, because you probably have a more interesting story.
No. I came from Rosendale, Boston.
Oh.
And we did move in because Lou had just gotten another degree at BC, and he needed to move out of Boston closer to where he had employment at that point. He got a job in Waltham, and we moved to Bedford in September of 1961.
Wow.
Been a long time. And we stayed, we bought a home on South Road, 2-bedroom. I already had a 4-month-old son. And we moved out in less than 3 years because I had 2 more children. So actually we moved up off of North Road Wildwood Drive. And we were there about 62, 63 years out on Wildwood Drive.
Were you the original owners there?
No, there was one owner before I was. Hmm. And we stayed there till, I think we moved out in 2020.
3 years ago.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And my daughter had built a house on the other side of town, but we stayed in Bedford. I couldn't leave Bedford at this point. And she built a home right next door to hers for me. So I can see her anytime I want. I just go out my door through the garage and into her house. I love it.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah.
And how large is your family now?
I now have 5 children.
Whoa, okay.
Yeah, I have that's 5 children within 8 years. I had 5 children within 8 years. 2 daughters in Bedford, a son that is in North Billerica, and a son in New York, and a son in Georgia.
Oh, okay.
And that's growing. I have 15 grandchildren.
Wow.
And 5 great-grandchildren.
Wow.
So they keep coming, and I'm accepting them.
Yeah.
So
we'll and see. As everyone will hear, even with that huge family, you've been so active and remain active.
I do, I love it.
Yeah, so we'll get to that. So how about you, Mike? Where were you living before you came?
You know, my wife and I went to high school together, and by the time we were in our early 20s, we were married with a baby, and I wanted to get out of central Vermont and be in Boston.
Oh, okay, Vermont.
I was a journalist, but I was ready to take anything just to get established. So I was hired to be the editor of the Tufts University Alumni Magazine in the summer of 1973. And my wife took one look at Medford and Somerville and said, I can't live here. We got to go back to Vermont. I said, well, let's find something that's kind of close to Vermont. So we started heading back there and ended up in Bedford. okay, this looks pretty close. There's cows here on Davis Road, you know. And,
right, it was a lot more rural then too, right?
So where are we gonna live? So Ben Sears, Bedford Real Estate, had an office right here where, on the corner of South Road and Great Road. And we just pulled up and there was a woman named Peggy Workman, I'll never forget her.
Yes, yes.
And I said, are there any apartments in this town? And she said, yeah, this is a great place for apartments. We were so lucky because that's unusual, even in those days.
Yeah.
And we started out in Bedford Gardens for a couple of years. Also lived on South Road before we bought our house on Concord Road in the late 70s and just stayed. But, you know, it's we still go back to Vermont a lot. I figured out once that if I draw a straight line from my house to Vermont, I don't have to go through any big cities.
Now, is most of your family local, or are they in Vermont?
No, we don't have very much family at all left there, but a lot of friends, a lot of people we grew up with, and it's so close. But, you know, one of my kids lives in Tingsboro, and the other one is in Brooklyn, so they're close. The grandchildren are close, and sisters and brothers live in New England and New York. So, but you know, family is, sometimes I feel like the whole town's family.
Right.
Even people I don't know, you know.
Yeah.
They chose to live here for some reason. It was just almost an accident that we landed here. But when you're here for a little while, you realize this is a good place. And for people a lot of people do the research and they come here with intentionally.
Yeah, that was me. I was renting in Belmont and considered buying in Belmont at the time. So this was 25 years ago, but the prices were astronomical for very little land, and I wanted land. And Bedford was ideal for that. The prices were still very competitive. And I had a friend who had moved here previously and loved it. So we researched it, started a good school system. Yeah, so it's interesting. So obviously you've been here for decades. Yeah. So I think what would be interesting to hear is thinking about what the town felt like culturally, even its landscape, what was available to you. How has it changed? And what would you say is the most dramatic change? What is it, 40, 50 years later?
I'd like to start because I want to make sure that I get to say it so I don't have to just copy you. To me, the biggest change is not anything that was caused here. It was totally the result of the market. What's happened is the range of people who can afford to move in and stay here has shrunk. A whole group of people have been priced out of Bedford. I know that you know what I'm talking about. When we lived here in the 60s and 70s, the people who worked for the town, so many of them lived in the town. I'm talking about teachers at the lowest point of seniority.
Oh,
I'm talking about truck drivers and snowplow drivers and police and fire and, you know, people in all kinds of blue-collar jobs. If somebody was a custodian in the school, they could afford to buy a house here.
Yeah.
And that's gone. You know, and that's not anybody who intend to do that, but we've lost the economic diversity, as have, I think, all of the cities and towns inside 495.
Yeah, I would agree.
It was, you know, and we also, you know, we had high earners, you know, we had executives, and we had highly educated engineers, as we do today, and physicians and professionals, and also the blue collar, and everybody got along. The kids played with each other, as they would today if they were here.
Right.
I don't know if you ever thought about that, but sometimes I'll go down the street and think, I know, you know, that's where so-and-so used to live.
He
worked a machine for the DPW.
Yeah.
Yeah, and also, I mean, we see it in the press. I hear people talk about it all the time. Not only is it difficult for blue collar to be able to live here, but daughters, even your daughters and sons, can't afford to live here and feel like they're forced to move out. And then the third segment, I would say, is people who have been retired and like you mentioned, Bobby, want to move out of their big, large homes and go somewhere more affordable. And I know that's an issue that the town is now trying to solve, affordable housing, more housing for seniors. But, you know, everyone's talking about that all the time.
Yeah, we both know people who have moved out of town because they didn't feel like they had options. And sometimes they don't have to move very far. Billerica, Chelmsford, and it's been an issue in Bedford for a long time, and there are people that are that have plans on in the works to try to do something about it. But even that isn't the answer for everybody. And well, you know, it's when I think about how many times have I heard people say, I could never afford to move here today if I was back in there.
I say that.
Yeah, and they can't move back in once they're out. Once they're out of here, they can't get back in.
Right. That's so true.
I know that the demographics really have changed. When my kids were growing up, there were a lot of younger families. In getting back to blue collar, like Mike touched on, most of us, I want to say maybe 90% of our high school graduates were in the DPW, the police, and the fire.
Oh.
Well, yeah, I mean, that
was our town.
And now they're all retiring.
They're all retiring now, and now it's so funny. You don't know the police, you don't know the firemen, you don't know the DPW. Mm-hmm. It's like a different town.
It was an aspiration, you know, for a kid like Scott Ricker to say, oh, my father has been a police officer for 32 years.
Yeah.
Look what a nice life he has. And now he's captain in the fire department, you know, in his mid-50s. And he's very happy. But are his children looking at the same type of career path? Yeah. Probably not. And it's not a value judgment. It's just, you know, this is what's happened here and probably in other places.
Yeah, as well.
I wonder, Mike, how many of our police, fire, and DPW people can afford to live in Bedford.
That's the point.
That is the point.
Yeah.
That's a challenge.
They just can't, you know, come back here.
Anything else, Bobby, that you think changed dramatically?
Not really. What we didn't have back then that we have now, about a third of the town are seniors.
Yeah. That's a big demographic thing.
We know that from Council on Aging.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah, that is something that is being addressed.
And, I'm very involved with that, and I just wish we could do more for them right now. We will.
Yeah,
we will.
Definitely.
One time there was before the Council on Aging, there was something called the Golden Age Club.
They used to meet at the Legion.
And I think Bill Beasley was the president of the Golden Age Club.
Yes.
Oh, that's cute.
Oh, they own the Legion.
Yeah, that's
funny. You can identify with this story. Charlie Hume, he must have been almost 80, and he was the volunteer head of the Chamber of Commerce.
Yeah.
So Bill Beasley said, why don't you come in and talk to us at lunch? So after his speech, Bill says, so Charlie, when are you going to join us here at the Golden Age Club? And Charlie said, I'll join you when I'm old.
Yeah.
And it was just like his frame of mind.
Yeah,
like,
right.
I can't do that. I got to work. You know, I'm the director of the chamber.
Yeah.
This is what I do. And I can so identify with that.
Yeah. There's a scholarship in his name.
Yeah,
fact,
he was quite a character.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Cool.
We had good
so,
people.
Probably the biggest reason for why I thought it'd be great to interview you guys, as I mentioned earlier to everyone listening in, is that you really stand out as icons here in Bedford for the amount of service that you've basically given to the town on many levels. And as a matter of fact, audience, I asked them to quantify their involvements over the years. And it's just unbelievable to me. I mean, we landed somewhere, the average between the two of you is around 100. 100 different committees, boards, town appointments, one day events, long-term events. I really marvel at that. And knowing you both very well, you are just as active. You know, it doesn't seem to be slowing down.
No,
so
not.
What I'd like you to do is take a little time. And Bobby, why don't you start on this one? Why don't you share with everyone, because obviously there's way too many for us to cover, but share with everyone the two or three committees or appointments that you have been involved with that have been the most meaningful to you and why?
Well, meaningful to me is, depends on my age at the time, the age of my kids,
sure,
how I feel. I was very involved when my kids were young with the schools. I would do anything in the schools, PTA, anything that they needed to be involved.
Because you had five going through almost
I had five
same
that
time.
Went through the whole right. system, right?
Wow.
And they were well educated. So I, as the kids got older, I went into the school committee. I didn't see things, some things I didn't like, and some things I loved, but the ones I didn't like, I wanted to try to fix. Uh-huh. Not that I fixed them all, but I got very involved. We had some turbulent years, long till 2 o'clock in the morning. Mm. Some of our school committee meetings lasted too.
Was there an issue?
Oh, we had several issues.
Yeah.
The good ones were we brought METCO in.
Yeah.
We brought the ROTC in.
Oh, right.
Were you involved when we started closing schools, or was that after you got out?
I was on the committee when we closed the neighborhood school, which was terrible. I had some of my best friends were very upset with
me. Is that because
of the population? Yeah. It was declining enrollment, okay. And we closed that.
Yeah, the town center used to be an elementary school.
Yeah, we used to have four of them. We used to have four elementary schools. We closed Center.
Wow, I didn't realize that.
And Page School became condos. But Center School, people couldn't understand, being the neighborhood school, how we could close it. Well, it took five people on the committee to decide that. There was a lot of asbestos in Center. There still is in the attic.
Okay.
It wasn't anything that we could fix. To make an addition on it, to do anything, it had to be closed. A lot of people were not happy, and I feel bad about that. But it was the best thing. If we didn't close Center, we wouldn't have a COA today. So one went into the other. The other thing we did is we had two superintendents that we had to let go.
Oh.
Right, one after the other.
It's almost inconceivable today.
Yeah. Wow.
One after the other.
These were performance issues?
Yes. Issues that, what
big.
I just started to say to Mike was, one of them, and I feel bad now when I think about it, but it had to be done. One of them became a hostage with the Iran situation. He was a hostage. And he has since passed away.
Wow.
And the other one, I don't want
to. He started a restaurant.
He started, yeah.
He said, I would rather run this restaurant than continue to do this.
Yeah.
But it really, it all turned around in the early 80s.
And that's when I was.
It's like somebody turned a page and said, okay, we're done.
Two of them in the row. It was a terrible, terrible. That's why we had late meetings. They were long, long meetings.
Oh, I can imagine.
Now, yeah. Were you on the committee that hired Superintendent Buckley?
Yes.
Okay,
in
so
fact,
you know, they could
my
wear
husband
that.
Is the one that interviewed him. He came from Maine, I think it was. And my husband went to Maine and interviewed him, and he came home, and he couldn't say enough about him.
And that's when things started to change.
Yes. So Joe Buckley came in after the two had gone out.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the town was satisfied that that happened. I think we had a lot of dissatisfied parents at that point. Mike?
Yeah, I agree. I mean, I was here as a reporter then.
Yeah.
What decade is this?
Through the 70s.
70s?
70, yeah.
Okay.
I think...
I came in 73 and within a year was the editor of the Bedford Minuteman until the early 80s.
Right.
So these... I was never in government then, but I felt like I was because I was always at the government meetings and trying to write them up the way I do now. And And so I'm so familiar with the personalities and the issues from those days.
Yeah. And you got good exposure to the way the town ran.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
He wrote a good article every time he had to.
Anything else, Bobby? Was there another group?
I mean,
I know you were
here.
A great contributor to the Friends of the COA.
Oh, I got that as another bullet. But
yes.
Hanscom always, well, at that point, it grew, and it came into our school system from grades 9 through 12.
Right.
So that was another challenge with that. But it was funny, in those days, even with the challenge, we could use the base. We could go on and off just by flashing our headlights. But ever since 9/11, they've become much more
right.
Much stricter.
I used to do water aerobics over there.
Yeah.
At the base. It was a wonderful program.
And a lot of them used
so
the
sad
pool.
They shut it down.
Yeah, we were allowed to use the pool in those days too.
Right.
And they had a few things that they kept to themselves. It wasn't like it is now. We weren't we're almost like one big family at this point. The base commander, Tayona, is just working so hard to make us one.
Yeah.
And she's doing a super job.
Yeah, you can see that.
I don't know if I, it just, it was it, a lot of changes, and that was just too much for us.
But you've always adapted to change. I mean,
yeah. Mike. You have to. I didn't like a lot of it, and you have to remember, and that's what people didn't realize, it takes 5 votes.
It seems like everything I've been involved with over the years, you were there first. It was like dollars for scholars. And the first time I go there, you were like running the reception. You know, and then I went on the school committee, and I'm not doing this on purpose. It was like,
you're following me,
when I became, I was president of the BAA after you and Lou did it. You know, it was like, well, these people are setting a good example.
I didn't even know that.
Yeah.
So now it makes even more sense you're both here. What about you, Mike? What would you say was the most meaningful?
Every time I think about that question, it changed my mind. And again, what you said is so true. A lot of it depends on the circumstances, the environment. Give you an example. Bedford Embraces Diversity is something I've always been proud to have been involved with near the beginning. Not because of what triggered it, but because of what a great positive response it had, and it gave me the opportunity to work on a Martin Luther King Jr. Day event, which we're ready for our 7th one now, and we never had that before. Yeah. So out of a bad thing comes something good. So that right there was I saw it as an opportunity to make a difference in the whole psychological environment of Bedford. Just reinforcing what I think the existing values are. I think the values here are very strong, and especially when I see what happens in other places, I think the military is one of the reasons for that. I think the influence of the military families on Bedford's personality is profound. You don't really realize it.
Yeah.
They integrate so much through the high school population, like you said. But being a selectman for 12 years was a tremendous honor because it just gave you entree into so many different aspects of municipal life. And some people have the discipline to make a tangible difference who say, this is a project that I'm going to work on and I'm going to see it through to fulfillment. And there's so many examples of that. There are so many examples within the town of projects that are long lasting, that people started from the grassroots, like the BLT with Joan Melville, or like the day camp with Ilse Gottlieb. She had an idea, and she nurtured it. And today it's like an institution. Springsbrook Park was started by volunteers.
Even the citizen.
And the town, the Bedford Citizen is a great example.
Three people really got together.
And the town center, that was just an idea. It wasn't government handed it down. People brought it to government and said, this is our plan. I don't have the discipline to do that. I just like to try to change the mood. I just try to get involved with things that'll make people appreciate where they live, the quality of life, the quality of the people around them. So when I get involved in something like coaching, or if I get involved in something like Dollars for Scholars, it's for me to physically reinforce the values that people already have. And you know, I helped raise money for the playground that they built in the center of town. And I said, this is a good thing. There's people that are already involved with the project, I'll try to raise some money for them. And when
you
I look down,
you also have fun too,
yeah,
though.
Yeah, and that's and I really not everything.
Aren't you the announcer for the football?
Well, I've been doing that's like 40 years of that.
Yeah, that's amazing. But you can tell you enjoy that. I mean, like, I'm not a big football fan. The couple times I've gone, I can hear your sense of humor coming through.
But it's a little bit, you know, it's just a contribution. It's a way for me to say there are people working really hard to do this. The players, the coaches, the administration. I want to contribute something to make them feel appreciated, to make them feel valuable. And so you collect enough of those things and you get quite a resume. But I think that looking at it from 20,000 feet, I like to be able to think that I've contributed to the quality of life that way.
Without a doubt.
And to define quality of life, a lot of it is intangible. It's like you get up in the morning, you say, I live in Bedford, and that's not a neutral statement. That's a statement of, you know, who you are in terms of your own values.
Right. Yeah, I totally relate to what you're saying in that, you know, I try to be involved in things as well, and I have a lot of peers who live in other suburban towns, and they don't have that engagement, and they're constantly saying, well, why do you care so much? And I said, I don't know, it's contagious. It's something about living in that town. You feel like there's opportunity to help make a difference. And I'm surrounded by people like you guys who've been doing it forever. So there's a lot of good role models for it. And that's what I would say to you. I'm getting up there in years, but being a little younger than both of you, that you are incredible role models for my generation and the generations to follow. And that's why I think it was so important to capture your thoughts so that this will basically, you know, be with Bedford forever.
It's such a nice compliment. Thanks for saying that.
Yeah, you're welcome. So the next thing I want to ask you about has to do with Bedford Embraces Diversity's mission. And that is basically to appreciate, celebrate the diversity in this town. And as you mentioned, Bobby, the demographics have really changed. Even in the time, you know, 20 years I've lived here, it's incredible. I mean, there's an explosion of the Southeast Asian population. There's, you know, a big shift in terms of ageism. I mean, having a lot older people that live here now. There was, I would agree with you, there was a time where there were not a lot of younger families, but at least in my neighborhood now, half the neighborhood has turned over, and it's all couples in their 30s with babies and toddlers.
Very nice.
I didn't think I was going to see that again. I mean, it's really something.
You're not ready
something.
To build another school yet, I hope.
I'm wondering.
Oh, the enrollment's
really
down.
So what I want to ask you about is related to diversity. If we were to say on a scale of 1 to 10, how would you say Bedford, the town, actually is embracing diversity from, you have different perspectives on this, which is fine, but from your perspectives of whatever you're involved with now, how would you answer that question?
Me? Mike, you want to go?
Yeah, I thought about this a lot, and I don't know how accurate it would be to go 1 to 10, which certainly it's not 10, but it's up there. It's 7, 8, or 9, and I can think one of the frustrating things, which stems from what I was talking about before, is that the population of African Americans is smaller than it was when we moved here.
Yes.
Because there was a corps of retired Air Force that would stay here. Their last duty station was Hanscom. And they would say, you know, this is a nice town. Yeah. Let's stay here and bring up our children here.
Right.
And a lot of them were officers. You know, we just had a funeral for Rachel Murphy. Her husband was a retired lieutenant colonel. Yeah. They moved here in the late 60s and they brought up 5 children here and stayed here. Mm-hmm. And there was a whole core of people like that. Many of them retired military. Military pension isn't going to buy you a house in Bedford anymore. We had a group called Concerned Black Citizens of Bedford because there was enough of a critical mass to have that. And maybe there is today, but they're not organized. I think it's really important. I'm glad that we have Medco to give us that aspect of a diverse population.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, I spoke before about the need for more economic diversity. But the way that the town has welcomed these 250 or so migrants from Haiti and from South America, to me, says everything you need to know about who we are.
Yeah,
that's
great.
That it's not only government, but so many private groups make sure that they feel welcome, that they have what they need in terms of clothing and shelter, and now starting to get job opportunities. And they've moved into the schools seamlessly, seamlessly as you can by not knowing the language. And I would they might all have left by the end of the next year and found more permanent places to live. But the way the town responded to that, especially compared to what we've seen elsewhere, reinforces the feeling I have that we look for opportunities to welcome diversity and to embrace it and say, you know, we can learn from this. It's a two-way street.
Right. Yeah, I think that's such an excellent example. I am personally very proud of how this town and citizens have responded to that situation. And honestly, I didn't feel that the response was as, well, at least it wasn't obvious to me that when the homeless were placed there was a different reaction. And I'm not sure why that's changed so much, but I am so glad it has, because I totally agree with you. The reception now has just been outstanding, really. Well, what do you think, Bobby, in terms of diversity?
I gave it a 7 to 8. I think we got some great people now. They're forming several different types of committees, and I think we're doing a good job. We can do better, but we're going in the right direction.
Yeah.
I think we really, really are. And I'm just proud of how the town has accepted them. I don't know what these new committees are going to be doing, but there's enough interest to form new committees for whatever they want to do, you know, to help make the town very diversified.
Yeah, the effort's there.
Yeah.
Okay. So my last question has to do with wish lists. and we are close to the holidays here. Not that Santa's going to take care of this, but if you had to make one wish, or more than one even, for what you think Bedford could do to improve itself, what would that be, Mike?
I mean, it's. I suppose that my answer to that would not be universally regarded as the highest priority. It would be great to have a big, all-encompassing sports and fitness center with a pool and a gym and
outdoor. Almost got our pool, almost, one boat shy.
You know, at one time they were talking about putting the YMCA here.
Yeah.
I never really thought it would happen, and it didn't. But that's, some people might wonder why we didn't replace the gym at Bedford High. I was on the school committee the year we planned for the expansion and the renovation, and the reason there was no gym is when we were planning for that expansion, there was no guarantee we were going to get any state aid. We thought we might have to pay for the entire thing ourselves.
Yep.
So the school committee at that time didn't put on anything extra, and then we ended up getting 50% state aid. Oh, now you're telling us.
Yeah.
But you know, I mean, they're always talking about there's not enough room for the kids to play, there's not enough room for adult leagues. But there's a lot of major expenses coming up in the next 5 years. I can't see it happening unless, you know, there's a guardian angel somewhere. But that would be the top of my wish list.
Well, it's funny you should bring that up, because Bobby will be familiar with this. There's a member of the COA. He's actually a young dad. He's got 3 kids, and he was astounded to find out that if you're on the swim team, you have to go to another town to swim. And he's a big swimmer. He swam in college, and he wants his kids to be swimmers. So he is starting a whole conversation, at least in our neighborhood and with the COA, about this very subject. I was very disappointed, because there was some talk about bringing a Y here.
Yes.
And I'm not sure why it didn't happen.
It fizzled.
It just fizzled.
They said, well, you guys have to raise the money. And that wasn't part of the original conversation.
No. Who's you guys?
The people living here.
Oh, the population, okay. The residents.
Oh, that's different.
We didn't expect that.
Well, we had picked out a place for it and everything. We were going to put it out in the outfield of the baseball field on McMahon and near the middle school. But I don't think I ever actually believed it would happen.
Yeah.
Because I can't think of a single town anywhere that's this small that sustained its own YMCA.
Right.
It's more of an urban thing.
Yeah, I've been going to the one in Woburn for my PT.
Yeah.
They have a great one over there. I don't know if you've ever been.
Yeah, Woburn, Waltham, Lowell.
Yeah, they all do. What about you, Bobby? What would you say if you had one wish?
I wish there were more hours in a day.
Oh, that's a great answer.
That's what I wish. I have a few things that I'm wishing for.
Uh-huh.
I'd like to see lower taxes. And I'd like us to do, being COA, worked hard to get that building, very hard. So I call it my baby now.
Sure.
But I really would like to see a hope that we could do more for our seniors.
Mm-hmm.
You know, more housing for them. Just as much as we can do for them. They don't ask for much. In fact, a lot of people don't ask for what they really need. I remember at one time at Ashby Place, we used to tell them, they had nobody else, nobody around. We used to tell them when they get up in the morning to pull up their shade so the neighbors could see that they were okay.
Oh.
And if the shade didn't go up, it meant you were in trouble. And somebody would check on you. They're not doing that now. We're going to have to, you know, hopefully get them educated a little bit more for that. I wish we could have more safe, walkable areas.
Mm-hmm.
I think more people would like that. We're working on it. We have trails and we have sidewalks coming in. I'd like to see that. What else? The future generation looks up. The future generation, I want them to be able to look around and appreciate what they have in this town like I do.
Right.
When I first came to Bedford, I was only going to say 6 months. I promised my folks I'll be back in 6 months. I got to Bedford and that was the end. You can get me out of here now.
Right.
Yeah.
I know. Same here.
Yeah. I'm so proud of so many things in Bedford. I don't know where my wish should be the strongest, but we worked hard to get that COA building. I don't know. We had two people or two committees wanted. I wanted the COA. And the DPW wanted their big building, and we both went to town meeting, the same meeting,
mm-hmm.
and we both got turned down. So we decided we were going to go different times.
Yeah, so weren't we voting on the middle school at the same time?
No, DPW and COA. Uh-huh. And so I talked with Rich Warrington, who was the DPW director. He said, you go to the annual and I'll go to the regular town meeting.
Maybe they'll forget.
And
good strategy.
Well, we had, you know, the young kids that wanted the working at the DPW, they wanted that, and I didn't want them to knock the seniors out. And our seniors wanted the building. We used the old center school, which, as I said, if we didn't close that, we wouldn't have had a place to put it. And we had plenty of room at the time. But we've outgrown that.
Right.
Just like the schools, I was on several building committees for the schools. Each one of them had plenty of room. In fact, we put the regulation size gyms in, Mike. Do you remember?
Because,
put that in at the time.
So people could use them.
Yeah,
after
so the night people could
Which
use
they
them. They do. And a lot of people didn't want that. They wanted just a small little
for
gymnasiums. We fought for that.
Right.
So I just hope that this generation enjoys what they're getting, appreciates what they're getting, and passes it on.
Yeah, very nice thought. And I would like to make a wish. My wish would be that I hope that, given all of the new families that are moving in and new citizens of Bedford, that we have some more that are like you two. Because that's the greatest gift that we could have to this town.
That's such a nice sentiment.
And thank you so much for joining us and wish you both the best.
Thank you. Thank you for having us.
Thanks.